Thank you. Welcome all the panelists. I think we have a nice audience who all will be set to hear some good bites from us on the real estate sector. To start with, I must say that the real estate sector has been quite evolved in this part of the country, Bombay especially, in case of where it's a market. I feel that the law in terms of MOFA was quite stringent, strong, unlike other parts of the Indian, I will say, spectrum. And I think my co-panelists all over from this market would always agree with me that RERA that is came was not nothing new for people who want to comply, because I spent 3 decades of my life in Delhi, and I could say that the law in terms of real estate was next to zero. If today also someone speaks to me about my sanctioned building plan or an OC, that's something foreign to me if I am from Delhi market. Whereas in Bombay, there is a lot of importance given to the sanction plan as well as something, a document called occupation certificate. Nobody enters a building since you get an OC. So I think in the Indian market, Bombay has a different space. In addition, there is something called the DCR, the Development Control Regulation. Each and every person and customers knows what DCR is. Unlike in other parts, DCR is only an operational document. It's more like procedural law for the architects and other people. So keeping that in mind, I will start the discussion to the entire panelist and to the audience in terms of what has happened after RERA has come. So I believe RERA brought in certain important aspects. The 4 top aspects is it imposed certain obligations on the developers. It ensured that there are safeguards for the buyers. There is protection for the consumers. And there is transparency. The biggest thing they started with was making it mandatory for all the developers to register their projects. And when they say register, you need to bring in a lot of stuff into the registration document. You have to build in all your plans. You have to show your title. You have to show how much of encumbrance you have done, how much litigation is going on. And everything is transparent on the website. Anybody can go and search a site and get the details. Keeping that in mind, what has happened is Mumbai saw, and I should also appreciate that MahaRERA, as one of the regulators, has taken the best ride across all the real estate regulators across the country and come with such detailed regulations, guidelines, and put the ball in motion that we saw close to 20,000 registrations in the initial 2 years, which is a big number. And secondly, the number of complaint resolution that started is also significant. Close to 5,000 complaints have come so far, out of which already 3,500 close to have already been resolved. So I think in the approach, they have been very strong. Their intent is there. So that is one of the biggest thing. The other aspect, as you look at the numbers, 2018 started with, if you look at the last year, Mumbai market had close to, if I'm not mistaken, 85,000 units being launched across the country with new projects. We had close to 50% of that market was from Mumbai market. It clearly shows there is a demand. The market is there. And unlike other cities, Mumbai is a straight line. Delhi is around, so you can spread across. All cities can grow. But this is a straight line. So I think there's a lot of opportunity. We have something called redevelopment of societies. You do a lot of things, which is quite different from other markets. So the demand is here. And to start the discussion, I think I will move first to Rajivan, who comes from Oberoi and has a lot of projects under them. And the peculiar aspect which I like to start with, rather than going to the general discussion, is the appellate mechanism that happens if an order is passed by the MahaRERA. Thereafter, one important aspect is you have to go to the tribunal, and there is something called a pre-deposit. So Rajivan, any lights you want to throw, keeping your case or some other case, on how you have to handle a matter where you want to challenge a MahaRERA order and to go down to tribunal? Do you see some challenges out there?
Thank you, Sival, sir, and thank you, the audience. Yes, I'm giving the experience a real experience. When the promoter goes, both the party can go to appellate, but most of the times, the promoter goes. There is a section 43.5, the proviso. The proviso states that before hearing the appeal, a certain amount has to be deposited. So far, the RERA has passed orders stating around whatever the order passed, and some of them are before the appellate tribunal, and the appellate tribunal saying deposit anything between 30 to 50%. Now the appellate tribunal is also in a dilemma, whether the 30 to 50% is the correct or something else. So that is the way we, if you really read that proviso, the proviso is a lot of full stops and commas, a lot of commas rather. So what it states, if it is an appeal is against the penalty, it's like, you know, the, when RERA registration happened in the initial stage, a couple of penalty order passed, like the real estate agent is not registered, so some kind of penalty, and we overmeasure it. Developer advertised without the registration number, a huge penalty is imposed. So if somebody goes against such kind of penalty, it would be 30% or such other amount as may be determined by the appellate authority. That's one scenario. The second scenario would be the RERA passed order saying, okay, return the money to the customer, maybe with some compensation, maybe with some kind of interest. In such kind of appeal goes, if the 10 ratings saying the entire amount has to be deposited, entire amount to be refunded to, or entire amount to be paid to the LOT, along with the compensation, as well as the interest thereof. And third scenario would be the both. There could be some kind of order passed saying, because of the violations, the penalty, as well as refunding. In that scenario, the 100% of the refund and interest and compensation, plus 30% or such other amount of the penalty amount. So that is the one, if you look into the overall scenario, other than RERA, none of other enactment is saying the 100% deposit. So that is why even the RERA authority, even appellate tribunal also so far, bearing one cases, is also taking a lenient view. It should be anything between 30 to 50%. But the view has taken by the RERA authority, when we review with the act, whether the decision is the correct or not, we have to see from way forward how the appellate tribunal or thereafter the high court will review to this. So that is one. Second, also there is a provision, I am sure all of you are aware, the clause 18 of the model clause, model agreement, the binding effect, that if the customer is not coming forward for whatever reason, or LOT is not coming forward whatever reason to execute the agreement, at the end they're saying, okay, 30 days are over, the next 15 days you refund the entire amount without interest. So in this type of order, the couple of order passed, there's no violation from the promoter's point of view. Really speaking, promoter saying, I'm ready to give. The customers are not coming forward. LOTs are not coming forward. And RERA also saying, so, okay, how long you will go batting like this? There should be an end to return the money back. So if RERA saying, okay, return the money back without interest based on the binding effect clause of clause number 18 of model agreement, whether that kind of order is supposed to be challenged, then the question will be how much to be deposited? Because there is no really actually speaking in a violation from the promoter point of view. So the appellate authority is in a very dilemma, whether it is this type of case, whether anything to be deposited, or so far, whether it's a refund, compensation, interest, or penalty, so far it is 30 to 50% of deposit. So we all have to watch and see how it's going to evolve a way forward.
Thanks, Rajivan. I think everybody is aware of the changes that has happened in terms of the RERA Act, which is primarily looking at you need to mandatory register your project, you have to ensure that no advertisement in any form, whether SMS, WhatsApp, email, newspaper ads, nothing can be done without a registration happens. Subsequently, there is a restriction. You have to create an escrow account. You can't withdraw without a certification from a chartered accountant, structural engineer, and an architect together, confirming what you have spent is for the project. Then there is checks and balance in terms of how you can withdraw it, in what timelines. These are big challenges that are happening. And Amit, who comes from Radius Developers, who have been very aggressive in the last 2 years, you see these as opportunities or threats, or what do you see the regulations that has come so far, and especially the way Maharashtra has come with very detailed guidelines? How do you see these regulation either as a cost of compliance or as an opportunity?
Thanks, Rival. I'll start this discussion of mine from the very beginning of your discussion, where you said MOFA was already in place and there was not much need of RERA. I'll come to that. Just before that, I have been practicing with Khaitan and company on the other side of the table, where I have been representing clients or corporates against the developer. So every time the attitude would be the developer is pressing on the customer, the developer is pressing on the buyer or the corporate entity. Since 1.5 years, I've been again on the other side of the table representing a developer. And then I realized that there are certain practical difficulties, theoretical difficulties, bureaucratic difficulties a developer goes through. Yes, the developer is trying to stretch his leg out of the bedsheet, no doubt. Every developer does that. That's an ancestral legacy he gets. But at the same time, the system is not understanding one thing, that the developer also needs some support from the system. Everything should not go to the customer. Now I'll tell you how it comes. MOFA had everything which RERA had today. In fact, people assume MOFA, as far as the 20% deposit is concerned, once a 20% advance has been given by a customer, compulsory registration of the agreement for sale needs to be done under MOFA. RERA states 10%. Many developers, even many of my colleagues, have always considered 20% under RERA. If you read Section 4 and Section 4A carefully, it says that before any advance is being accepted by a developer from an allottee, the agreement for sale should be registered, but that advance should not exceed 20%, which means MOFA always stipulated, even though you're accepting 1% as an advance, you have to register. Whereas RERA was kind enough to get that limit to 10%. There were various provisions under MOFA with respect to change in plans or consent of the allottees. In fact, there is one more provision which got affected in August 2016 by the police authorities for filing an FIR against a developer, which comes from MOFA. That provision is not there in RERA. RERA has a procedure for penalizing the promoter, implicating penalties upon him, and then they could be imprisonment. So the concept of RERA came into place because of its peer, which had a series of success, such as your SEBI, your CCI, your IRDA, ITRAI. The UPA government, way back in 2007-08, thought about RERA. They said that there is a lot of success achieved by the other regulators. So let's come up with RERA, the same regulator. If you look at the act of RERA per se, a lot of provisions, a lot of ancillary miscellaneous provisions are similar to all these other acts where these regulators are there. So what has RERA differentiated today is brought a regulator, fine. And what Shrival mentioned, regulating your advertisement, regulating your commitments given to the allottees, that has been differentiated. Otherwise, there's no major difference between MOFA and RERA. The only thing is MOFA never had that teeth, what RERA has. So I, as a lawyer representing a developer, in the last 1.5 years, after RERA has come into force, I can conclude that it has brought the house of a developer in order to a certain extent. And I can vouch for it that promoters with whom we are representing, they are looking at RERA regime as a normal course of life, but the system is not with them today. How much I feel when I'm representing a developer or for the real estate sector, save and except 2005, where automatic FDI, 100% FDI was permitted. Save and except the repeal of ULC Act, where later on, obviously, there are other issues now going on with the Supreme Court. Save and except that, please tell me, what is the other incentives, what is the other benefit, what is the other environment given to a developer? Nothing. There have been RERA coming in, there have been GST, there have been IBC, there has been demonetization, and now developers are facing the NBFC financial crunch. So presently, RERA has been looked after as a, I can't say RERA, but the system overall, these tsunamis, which I've been telling again and again in various forums, this tsunami is looked after as a major threat to the developers. And consolidation is something which all of us are going to see in the next 2-3 years. That consolidation could be large developers or could be large NBFCs or investors such as Blackstone, KKR, there are many of them which are on the fringes to take over the projects from developer. So to be honest, in the next one or two years, you're going to see a lot of issues which are going to come up, a lot of complications which are going to be evolved under law, how to resolve that, how to help a developer weed out of these issues. I have no answer to that as a lawyer today.
Thanks, Amit. I think one of the, if I look back in the last 1.5 years plus, I see there have been 3-4 major challenges for all developers and also to consumers, or I'd say I will extend it to say the other stakeholders. In this system, the stakeholders are the banks, the financial institution will lend money both to the project finance as well as to the home buyers. There is a different class of customers in this market who are called the investors, who have surplus money, who want to come and invest in a project. And usually that used to be some amount of money that was brought in apart from the equity or from a project finance, and that is to be a good source of funds. In the new model, wherein you have to register the agreements, I think this will be a challenge because the investor community would not like to look it in that direction. So keeping that in mind, I believe there are two other major threats which all players will feel. One is the possession date, how you define it, how do you tell it. So there are two categories. For ongoing projects who comes in, they re-specify the date. So suppose there's a project that started in 2014-15, they had a delivery date of say 2018, and as RERA came with huge penalty, the people went and recasted the completion date. So that was one. Second important thing would be, there will be one category of customers who had a registered agreement allotment letter, which is the 2018 date, and a new person who comes with that say 2020 date, where a promoter would have relayed, put a buffer around it and extended the date. So there have been few judgments around this by the RERA where they have reheld those, MahaRERA has come and held that. So Sarthak comes from a background where he has done both. He has been on the in-house team and thereafter is now on the practicing side. How do you see RERA, having spent your effort on both sides of the table, how do you see RERA as a boom or it's going to be an opportunity for you?
Great. So thanks, Shrival, for this opportunity and coming on stage. Well, I personally believe that right from the time in 2015 when the RERA regime was getting drafted, during my time with Tata Housing under leadership of Rajivan, and then of course Rajivan moved on and then I continued as the legal counsel, I believe a lot of effort has been already put in place by developers to ensure that the RERA becomes workable for them as well as for the customers. Because at the end of the day, the commercial sense which lies with the developers is to give satisfaction to the end user. And if that is not being given on a larger scale in terms of the possession date, which is very, very basic. So for years, we used to hear that, an agreement which is without a possession date. So those were very common incidences. For years, we used to hear that, plans have got changed and there was an open space which was shown. Now it's two buildings have come up there. So where will our children go and play? For years, we saw that developers delayed the project. So these were much, incidences which were covered under RERA. Which were covered under MOFA. But RERA coming in, we realized that there is a sharper edge which is coming in by virtue of a new law. But my question is today, after spending 3 years of a RERA regime, do we really ask ourselves a question? Does RERA have a teeth? So while we say MOFA has a teeth and RERA didn't have a teeth, Amit just said, I have a reverse question to myself, that does RERA have a teeth? Because today we look at the government in a way where it will promote a sector one way, but also ensure a benefit for the beneficiary part of it, which is the end user customer. Today, every individual in this room would obviously have some sort of a house or an apartment which you have gone ahead and booked at some point of time, or maybe your parents or maybe your children have done. You ask yourself a question today, am I putting in the money in the right place? Isn't that a thought even if you're doing it with one of the top developers? Why? Because we've seen the failing times of the top developers who have some point of time committed, but as trending trends or you know, due to circumstantial reasons, or maybe taking up biting a larger bullet of taking too many projects and not having, you know, good teams in place, and attrition, which is the maximum on the real estate side, which I believe, you know, I've seen large organizations facing an attrition, huge attrition challenges today. So one of the major reasons for the sector to lack today is also attrition, because a single man who acquires a project is obviously required to deliver that to the customer. Does that really happen in today's trend? Is a question to be asked. So I think a huge introspection is required by large organizations as to how to retain people on one side to ensure that the project gets completed and gets delivered to the right people. So I think one of the reasons is attrition. Second, of course, is to work on the, you know, the workforce management, which is there. Third, of course, on, you know, various operational aspects. So while commitments are given to customers today for the right kind of product to be given, you know, today when we go out and see, we see brochures, we see the digitization age has actually changed our scenario. So there was a trend which came and it's recently come in. You go for a site visit and there is a 3D animation. You wear the whole, the VRs, and you actually take an experience of walking into your apartment. What a great feeling. So the guy comes forward and pays a 20%. Is that what developers are actually looking at? Or is that a delivery that they're looking at? Is a still, which is a question within myself, which I'm yet to answer. So I think a huge introspection from the industry side is one. Two, the regulators have done what they want to. But due to severe, impact, or maybe revenue being one of the largest challenges even for the state, I personally believe that forums which are formed for real estate are also at some point of time, you know, creating, some sort of a, you know, I would say a linear impact on how the decision making should be at some point of time. So from the government side, from the authority side. So I think there is, according to me, Shrival, you know, I have a different belief, being from the corporate side for 18 years and then coming into practice is a complete paradigm shift of looking from the customer's angle today or from the investor side today. Does he invest it in the correct place, and would after 5 years, the projections which are showed to him on day one or the property which is sold to him at day one, would he really get that in its letter and spirit? So I think that's where I am today.
Well, fair thoughts, but I think I've been in this industry for 2 years as a customer and as also in-house player. I believe two things is very important. The law that stood in MOFA was with a criminal liability on the promoters. People who knew the law used to impose that and do that. In addition to that, we have now a section 14 in the RERA Act, which speaks about how a change of plan of either a flat or inter layout of a flat of a customer or the entire layout or the building is changed. Compare that to what was there in section 7 of MOFA, which was very, I think, very basic. Now the spread is very detailed. Anything and everything you have to do. So if you are going to make a slight change in the internal layout, be it even changing the location of his, maybe a bathroom and turning it 90 degree within the layout, it's supposed to be called a change. Secondly, if you are doing a change across, you are giving a bigger amenity, changing the location, you need to have a consent of the customers. And having not done that leads to huge penalties which go up to 10% of the project cost. And if you're doing a big project, which has, say, a 5 wings with a big amenity, podium, etc., means a project of close to around 1,000 crores, if not more. And on that, a 10% penalty is 100 crores, which can make a difference between a positive project and a negative project. So these challenges are something which are going to come in across. And to add to that, the interpretations, the law is not in black and white, it's in grace. You need to interpret that to which side it means. There are huge challenges. So is that a challenge you see that will come? I think we had some judgments recently. I think Maharera came with one big, I think a novel judgment, I say, which is in the Bombay Realty matter, which speaks about if, say, 30% of the people walk out of the project, they say it will lead to a project closure. So hence, they said, we are not going to allow you exit. in an exceptional stage, they can move out, but they have to comply with what they have in the allotment letter and not a 10% penalty which is prescribed, which is the SBR 8 plus 2%. They're not giving those to them. So interpretations going here and there. How do you see these challenges? So Rajivan, do you have any thoughts on how a big developer today, when he looks at new projects, keeps these thoughts in mind, which is an interpretation gray area, very critical analysis of a statue compared to what was in the past? How do you would like to draft your, you know, contracts to protect yourself in the long run?
I think all of us must already read that the formal model agreement. And model agreement read with section 10 and 13 also. It's very clear that only four items we have to go as per the act. The rest of the things is we can modify, provided it is not, we are not violating any of the RERA provisions act. The challenge is, as you said, is it's in a layout project. It is a single project. The problem won't be foreseen much when we go for the larger layout. The larger layout, though, the promoter may go the launching the project on a phased manner. So in the phased manner, when project is launching, what in a larger area, what even we should in advance take is what is likely to come up in the rest of the phases. So what is counted to the total plan, the plan so far approved, and the plan likely, the building or whatever residential or commercial or whatever mixed together likely to come, and the amenities, and superimposing all of them and placing. Having said, the issue really is what is really is changing or no? I mean, if it is, there are two scenario. One is there is a change in the respective apartment, is slightly modifying the apartment of each. Then we need not go to the 51% consent. We can go to the respective the allottee and ask his consent and move ahead. And if it is the entire building or the layout is changing, okay, then the 51% requirement comes. When we really go for 51% consent.
Two-thirds.
It's recently now, RERA come out with an order. So that's for extension. That's extension. So two-thirds. The two-thirds getting approval for consent is a Herculean task. So we lawyers or the in-house people has to at least think out how to come out this type of issues in future vis-a-vis not violating the regulations.
So, Shrival, I'll just add to this. Mr. Rajivan mentioned that it's a Herculean task for a developer how to go to every allottee and seek their consent for change in plan under Section 14. This is where I can advocate that the developers have been mindful compared to MOFA and now in RERA. They've been very mindful about Section 14 over here compared to Section 15 of MOFA. All of us must be very aware of the blanket waiver, irrevocable consent. In the MOFA regime, every developer used to sign a contract, an agreement for sale with an allottee where they had a clause that any change in plan in future due to increase in FSI, due to purchase of TDR, due to other incentives available to the developer is free to change that plan, and the allottee hereby is giving a blanket irrevocable consent. That used to go on. Sooner or later, that was struck down by court. And while being in Khaitan, and while coming here also, we've been insisted upon, have that blanket consent in your contract. Have that blanket consent. Maybe it'll work. I can second that fact that developers have appreciated one fact that this is not going to work.
Because added Section 14 clause 2 starts with a non-obstinate clause.
Yeah, so this is not going to work. Instance. But still you will file contracts with those blanket consents. But this is not going to work, which they know within themselves. And say they today spend 6 months extra before launching a project, a minimal, to be ready with your plan and not to change it, not waste any further time. Because of the reason the markets are not good, one. Two, the interest is hovering on every developer. The rates of interest are not good enough to really service. So today they know one thing, that this is my focus, and this is where I can see allottees benefiting. As far as the date of possession, which is concerned, whether it has teet or no, it has many teets in the RERA authority today. There are one judgment where I can cite, Mr. Chatterjee himself cited that the act should not be looked in isolation, but it should be read harmoniously. That's why this particular order, this is dated somewhere on 16th October 2018, clearly state that somewhere similar to the Bombay Realty order also, where it clearly states withdrawing at this moment. And he admitted in the order the developer doesn't have the money today to refund to you also. So what will you do by withdrawing that? He extends, so the extended date mentioned under the RERA website is preponed to an extent where the developer has also been questioned whether will you be able to deliver within this preponed date. If not, be ready to pay interest after that. The developer says, okay, I am with you. The order is preponing the date of possession as mentioned in RERA, and life goes on after that. That is harmonious. There is another judgment by the adjudicating officer recently, which says that if there is no date of possession mentioned, and if you have given an extended days of possession on the RERA website, a reasonable date of possession is 3 years if there's delay. And they have cited the Supreme Court judgment of Fortune International. So we are confused. We'll have to base our arguments based on the authority we are going.
And one more interesting point now, if you say we have to take the consent from the LOT even for the assignment or the change of the promoters. So we are all are, it is just what we are foresee, we have forward a lot of merger acquisition and the consolidation. Okay. And also, we will see most of the industry house, the real estate division could be a separate division, may not be a separate entity. It's a division could be the main operating company. So if that industry house decides, okay, my real estate division should go to now a separate entity by way of demerger, the question will ask whether again the consent of the LOT is required, or whether RERA has the authority to approval, or suppose the demerger and merger goes to the NCLT, and NCLT gives approval, that is sufficient or not. A lot of debates are happening on this area because way forward, as Amit mentioned, the consolidation definitely is going to happen.
So Rajivan, currently we have in a project in my company where we acquired a stressed asset. We are working on a model which is the most complicated one, and I think we are working, it's a long journey. So we acquired the asset, went on as a development manager so the project work doesn't stop. We went on and there is a change of plan because the DCPR 2034 gives more benefits to me. I have been modified, there's something. I am working towards a consent which gives consent both for change of ownership under 15, read with the change of plan under 14. We are going to individual players. We say we will not come as a promoter unless we get the consent. The plan won't be changed and the date is going to be the same. So it's a big challenge. But I think this is what will take the best out of all the in-house and legal experts, how we draft innovative solutions out of these problems. And in that light, I would like to bring Saurabh on the panel to throw his lights. He comes to the background working with Solomon, where he has been looking at, you know, transactions, building up the entire deal. What do you see as challenges, or what was not a challenge earlier is a challenge now? And how do you would like to be in this hot chair of advising a new promoter or an FDI player to come in India and say, please do this?
Thank you, Saurabh. So, taking back what my panelists and my chairpersons spoke about the RERA implementation, the nuances the developer is facing, and what are the solutions to all these problems that they've been facing every day, the investor coming in, and investors are no more coming in because now they are afraid that they will become a promoter to the project. They don't want to take the obligations of becoming a promoter. So what are the solutions to all these issues where two-third consent is required from a purchaser who's been an allottee to the project? So there have been several advices and solutions which have been given to the developers at large, and they have been taking it up. For an example, for a consent where two-third allottees consent has to be taken, the developers have been advised that for a bigger layout where five buildings are coming in a larger layout, rather than registering them as a one project, register them as a five projects, because every building individually could be registered as a single project. Where in case if there's a layout change in one building, you don't have to approach the other four buildings. the allottees of the other four buildings. So depending upon how the law has placed itself today, it is very important that the advice should be such where the developer could align itself for a more solution-oriented approach. More together with the transactional documents, if you see recently, there have been judgments about, in Mumbai, for example, there is self-redevelopment, as he said, that Mumbai is a straight line for a development, for a society redevelopment, sorry. Society has been contesting as co-promoters. Recently, there has been a clarity from RERA that they should not be considered as a co-promoter because the obligation of redevelopment has been casted upon the developer. So they should not become a party in case of any disputes have been filed by the allottees. Going forward, in terms of investors who are holding land parcel under the FDI regime, the transactional documents where they enter into a joint development agreement or a development agreement based upon their whether it's a revenue share model, whether it's an area share model, the owners, the landholding partners, they usually don't come with an obligation because they don't have the expertise of how to develop a land parcel. They have come as an investor to the entire project. So how you tackle the situation when there is some obligations which are casted upon the developer in a development agreement should be, in case of the default by the developer, how should the owner of the project or the investor of the project could be safeguarded? Because that's what the first point that the investor would raise, that I would come for a development agreement, execute a development agreement with you, but how would I safeguard myself? So in terms of your transactional documents, when a owner is coming, his major obligation, if you see, is the title to the land parcel. Now, depending upon the title to the land parcel, title insurance was to be notified under the RERA regulations, but till date we have not seen it's been notified. However, there are certain banks and insurance companies which are providing, one of being the HDFC, okay? And these reinsurance like Marshall and all are coming in. But however, I don't see the government taking active participation, formulating the insurance regulations in place which could have this title insurance place. So because there are two aspects of title insurance. One is the aspect towards the allottee, because he feels more secure that tomorrow if there's a title dispute or a litigation which may contemplate a stay order on a project, okay, that is safeguarded in terms of the insurance because the cost has been taken by the insurance company. Second, it is very beneficial to the owner who is as an investor coming to the project itself, because he feels somewhere that he's safeguarded from his obligations for title insurance. Now, going forward, what we have suggested in the transactional documents that we've been doing is that the indemnity is being casted upon the developer in terms of his obligation under the development agreement. So these are, though contractually you may agree with the developer that the indemnities and the obligation to fulfill whatever is required under the RERA is there, but still date, those owners and investors are still promoters of the project. So they cannot, though the solution to is that yes, they are indemnified. Yes, the obligations are costed under a contract upon the developer, but at the end of the day, under the Act today, they are still responsible for the project. So the entire responsibility cannot be costed against the developers, though they are still liable for the project in case of a joint development agreements and otherwise. So in terms of these regulations going forward, it is an evolving regulation. There are so many precedents and cases, there are so many loopholes, gray areas, okay, which needs to be still addressed in terms of the regulatory perspective and how it has to be enforced. So my submission at the end of the day from the transactional structure point of view, it always depends upon how your investor or how your developer wants to place a project to himself and how you can guide them and advise them on these transactional structures.
Is the risk appetite high?
Obviously for the developers, it is very high.
Very high. Adding to what he said, that particular section is section 16 on insurance, which has not been notified by the state government. The state government is also supposed to notify that. There have been rounds by various underwriters, Marsh, Lloyd, all of them. But government is not yet taking initiative to formulate the policy for insurance. This is one difficulty the allottees are facing, as Saurabh mentioned.
I want to add one thing, is that once you say the title insurance is going to be there, it is not going to come from the pocket of the developer. It is going to be marked up in the cost of the flat itself. So if the allottees are still looking at that, I want your views also that ultimately the cost of the apartment is going to go up. in this market where there is hardly demand-supply mismatches already there, do you think it will be in the interest that a title insurance is brought on the table?
As far as allottee is concerned, the interest is very much needed to be brought on the table. As far as the developer is concerned, you hit the bullseye. The premiums which have been proposed by the underwriters are very high for us, very high to be implemented. So that may go into the cost of the project also. But you fail to remember one thing over here, the benefit of the insurance, once the project is completed, is passed on to the allottee. So whatever we are charging the allottee in the flat cost, the benefit will be availed by them. So if they have to invoke that insurance policy, they are the one who is going to benefit. I will not be receiving a single penny. This is one aspect where he says the developer is facing issue, even the allottee. My major concern on this forum is doing business in India, single window clearance. It came up in 2008. After that, we've never seen that window being opened for us. Inaction, Saurabh mentioned about the inaction of the government under Section 17. There is one Section 72 or 74 where the state government is empowered to authorize the authority to give any directions for the benefit of the stakeholder. Doesn't say for the benefit of the allottee, for the benefit of the project. So one implementation to be given by the government, which we don't see the light of the day, is a single window clearance. We run across 111 departments. If that is being streamlined, 3 years is definitely a reasonable period to deliver a possession of the flat.
Rajuni.
Yeah, Amit, what you said about the investors and DM model and JD model. Our experience with the authority is saying you disclose as much as is possible. You disclose everything. If you disclose, okay, my responsibility is this, put it in the website. So at least that will safeguard protecting the way forward. Because if you don't disclose, because everything is now available, whether it's a plan approved, one can go and see from the MCGM's website. So disclose. My advice would be to disclose. Everything disclose. We always say confidential. Nothing confidential is in this world, in the digital era. So if we disclose everything, the responsibility also will be limited. And we have a multiple promoter, whether investor promoters, whether DM model. If we disclose, our response will be limited to that.
Three things which RERA propagates under the preamble: transparency, accountability, and efficiency. Transparency is coming up due to the digital era, due to your web portal. Accountability, the developers are sinking into it, but the system is not with them today. Efficiency, as sort of many of us pointed over here, in all the stakeholders is yet to come. It's not there.
Just like to add to this, with a certain amount of experience on the RERA orders which have come recently. So while RERA orders are passed by the level one, how do you execute those orders? How do you take it to a next level of execution? Because there is no execution proceeding per se as per RERA, which is unsettled completely. So I think while the law is being developed one way for the purpose of benefit of the customers, there is also a teeth which is required now in RERA. I think from this forum, I believe, we should make it a point, because it's just not so. While it becomes a win-win situation for both, that yes, customers do need a better place to stay and they pay for it, is there a way in which they get a resolution? So today, a window dressing of an order at the first level just does not help, because the actual payment which arises by virtue of that order takes the longest of period for an individual who's gone to the forum, to attain justice. So, from both sides, I believe there is a lot of reformation which is required for the purpose of bringing in the perspective of transparency, because that transparency is yet hazy. It's not transparent.
So, as you're all aware, there was an interim appellate tribunal, and now we have a final tribunal in place, and we got a lady judge who is looking at things. There have been two good orders that I recently read across. There's one of YBB Rane where they recasted the position date, and the other order of where society was the Udyanchal Goregaon matter, where they clearly held the society is not a party. I think things will evolve. It's a long play to go. But apart from these challenges, one other big challenge which I see across is GST. Over a period of last 1.5-2 years, we have seen different notifications, different aspects, and the latest one which reduces the GST and delays the implementation day by another 45 days, leading to customers not making the buy decision and not giving us an income, the input credit. And which is the biggest aspect which, you know, drafting documents. So, Saurabh, what's have been your views over the last 2 years when you've been drafting contracts? I did some transaction where, you know, the biggest point was not about indemnity, which used to be there in the long run. It's now about the GST. How do you draft the clauses? Some throw your lights on the same.
So, let me take it back. Before 2017, when the GST came in, the CGST Act in 2017. See, before the home buyers, just let me start with the home buyers, how it came up, okay? There was a service tax and a VAT implication. VAT implication was 1%. Service tax implication was 4.5%. In total, making it a 5.5% to a home buyer. CGST came in 2017, came with an implication of straight 18% GST on home buyers, which was thereafter reduced to 12% because the land should not be a part of it. Under the supply definition, which has been defined, an exemption of the land transfer or the immovable property transfer. Now, taking forward from 12% where the input credit was available to the developer, now it has also included that any supply of development rights, supply of FSI, supply of TDR, even the licenses, even the leases, everything has to be put across a GST of 18%. So, during the regime from 2017 until date now, when we draft documents where a development agreement has to be drafted, for example, a DMA model, for example, development management agreement has to be drafted, one has to not only look at the GST aspect, which is very important, one has also to look at the structures, what you are drafting, in terms of what would be the point of taxability. Whether the point of taxability, not only from the indirect taxation, which is GST, but from the income tax perspective as well. Whether the owner of the property is holding the property as a capital asset or is a stock in trade. Whether the association with the developer or the two developers coming in or would be looked as an AOP. So all these aspects when you're drafting a development agreement or an agreement or a collaboration agreement or a JV agreement for that matter, one has to look at the aspects that how you have to treat it. For example, in a revenue sharing model, though there was no GST implication in terms of the owner not receiving any area or the other developer bringing the development rights not receiving, after this regime came in, there was, when you write in a document, it's a license has been granted to the developer. So there was somewhere the implication was that the certain development rights has been licensed to the other developer and it was concluded to be service passed on to. And the implication on the one who receiving the development rights has to bear the cost of the GST. So the entire model of how to frame the documents have changed over a period of last 5 years after the GST has come, before the GST was there, in terms of all these direct and indirect taxation. And with the recent notification which has recently come, which implementation is supposed to happen from the 1st April 2019, where there is a reduction in the cost of the GST for the home buyers for affordable housing from 5% to 1%. And in case of a normal home buyers from 12% to 5%. Though those notifications are yet up and will be implemented from the 1st of April. However, there's a 19th March, which is on Sunday. The GST council is again meeting on certain aspects which have not been touched. For an example, when Shrival spoke about the development agreements, they have also exempted not only the home buyers, they have also given certain relief to the developers as well. When we are talking about GST implications on a development agreement for residential properties, for long lease, for supply of FSI and TDR in case of residential premises, the GST has been exempted. However, commercial developments, wherever industrial developments, even further logistics parks development, warehousing projects, there is no exemption at all. Plus, on top of that, there has been no clarity in terms of whether it's a mixed use, how the GST implication would be there in case of a residential and a commercial where there's a mixed use, whether the components would be divided and the GST would be calculated, and how the transaction will happen from the existing policy to the new policy. So all those aspects are yet to come, but I feel that the document which needs to be drafted needs to be drafted in such a manner where you have to consider the aspect and also consider the feasibility that the developer is looking at. If he's going to pay the entire portion of his income or profits in taxation, why would he do a project? And because it does not affect the developer at the end, it affects the actual home buyers, because all those additional tax, all those revenues which have been taken from the developer are actually passed on to the purchasers.
So you rightly said this point. In fact, recently the MCHI has made a representation to the government. If you actually look at the rates of houses of Bombay, minimum 40 to 45% of what you pay goes as premiums and other charges to the government. So what you see, people speak about a high rate of land across in Bombay, 40%, 45% goes to the government, not to the either a developer or to, it goes away. So I think that's one important thing. But what you rightly said, I think the most important thing which I see today is that any GST rules, regulations that come should at least be there for at least a static period of 1 to 2 years. Because every time you do a transaction today, I will execute a transaction basic what is there. If I have to, a transaction may go over a period of 3, 5, 8 years depending on the parcel of land. It's going to be very difficult for me to now do an agreement and live with a change law when it comes later. I think that's a big challenge we are going to look at.
You will get that static period after the general elections. Not before that, to be honest.
I think, okay, on that note, I will say there are two big challenges I see for the industry per se. One is going to be the funding coming from the banks and the NBFCs in this market. Two, the supply-demand mismatch, because what we see today as surplus may not be a surplus in the right instant. It may not be a project going to deliver. So our understanding, which I see, is that good developers will bring in certain products over a period of time, but there will be a shortfall of supply coming from the fringe players because they can't do compliance. So they, in the long run, the prices will again go up because there will be a supply-demand mismatch, especially in a market like here. On the other side, I see four big factors which will be positive for this demand. One is a new concept of REITs, REITs is going to come, which will be not only good for the service apartments, in the types of how the rentals come. So I think Blackstone is already coming with that. That's going to be the one big aspect. The second is people will start looking at ready-to-move-in homes. They will not look for under-construction projects. And I note that institutions like Piramal is coming with funding schemes for developers to fund the entire project from start till end. And they will have some buy-in restrictions on selling the project. So they will fund a project so they don't have to go to the regulatory issues. Third aspect, which is bigger, I will say, is affordable housing is the next in thing where people look at it. But in a Bombay market with a 45 lakh and a 50 square feet area will not find, 50 square meters area will not fly. So I think the threshold will have to be changed. And last, I will see that the element of brokers or real estate consultants coming as an intermediary will die, because all the big people, as rightly put by Sarthak, will go to a digital mode, both in terms of an app to launch the project digital. In fact, many of us have already gone into online sales. We have started units abroad for looking at the NRIs in those areas where they want Indian diaspora living abroad. They want to look at it, whether you call it a London market, Dubai market, Singapore, people wanting to invest. So I will see a certain change happening. So these all will have challenges. So Sarthak, do you see any area where specialists like you will come and deliver something different what has been done in the past as advisors to the corporates?
Well, I think there is a huge scope. As you know, since the time we have a new government in place since 2014, I believe there have been more than 400 acts which have got changed. So the larger challenge lies with the lawyers to learn those acts first and apply an implementation process rather than merely get into the mode of advising. So I think there is a huge introspection which is required. As simple as when I look at it today, as I started practice in 2001, the law relating to check bouncing was different then in 2001. And today you have a complete paradigm shift of a deposit to be done before the court as the check complaint goes to the court. So I think that itself gives you a larger scale of understanding the law at the first instance. Secondly, to look at changes in law again as a shift, the legal fraternity is responsible, and I believe the gatekeepers for the larger corporate houses as well as people who need legal services. So coming from a legal background of family lawyers and people with, you know, having experience of working with eminent people across in the last 18 years, I think the understanding which I get personally is that on a daily basis, we do need a huge amount of input and introspect to give advice to the people who are around us, rather than merely considering, you know, yourself as an outfit. Because I have the trend which is going, you know, which has gone over the last few years, is that today larger corporates are only going to top law firms or, you know, the top cadre in the industry. So, you know, considering, you know, having experienced on the corporate side, I think now gives an insight that there is a good reasoning for, you know, independent lawyers too, who have worked in corporate houses, getting a gateway for, you know, for a way forward. Talking on, you know, a few things, just to cap on a few things which Shrival said, I think that the trend which is now changing the real estate is more on, you know, five or six major things. And I made a note of it just before coming. So I personally feel one is changing reforms, as I said. Second is an increased transparency and accountability, which is largely more required. So yes, we've seen a regime where at one point of time we had the changes in law coming in. There is an execution change which is required, where, you know, those laws start getting executed at some point of time. Third, I would just like to put on the fact that, you know, there is a huge consolidation which is going, you know, within the real estate industry. So I think the formation of the JV, the smaller people getting merged with the larger developers, and, you know, the commercial space development, which is again in fray, so warehousing. And last but not the least is to get out of the stress of the NBFC. So I think that part, so once the funds get released, I think the market will start moving again in a way which is, I think, desired. So I think that is where we are, I believe.
I would take the opportunity to end the session with a question to the chairperson over here. For the benefit of everyone other than real estate, this topic is, just for you all to know, Shrival has been, in his career in the past, dealt with regulators such as the media and the telecom. My question to Shrival, for the benefit of everyone, is how had you seen those sectors come up with such confusion as we face today in RERA? And how have they been regulated today and life has moved on with those sectors? How do you compare that with RERA in the next 2-3 years?
It's a good question. I had opportunities working in telecom sector, media, and airports. So what you see is, when a regulator comes in an industry, it starts with, in a nascent stage, to doing over-regulation, because they have to put the house in order. You will see an approach from the tribunal which is pro-customers. And that will start because you have to shock the sector. Unless you shock it, they don't want to comply. That will start, and over a period of time, there will be few judgments that come from the tribunal and maybe high courts and Supreme Court, which will clarify things which are in the gray area. So that's the biggest thing. And later, it all depends on a regulator, how he wants to take the role. So today in Maharashtra, you have a MahaRERA regulator called Gautam Chatterjee, who brings on himself the important aspect. And given that he has done past stints in various aspects of regulation within Maharashtra, I think that's an important thing, that it's a role of the regulator to move from an over-regulation to a soft touch, where they come only when the market is not performing to interfere at that stage. So they do something called forbearance. They push back themselves and they lay down the principles, and if the market don't perform, they come in and say, don't do that. That's something that happened in telecom. Initially it was high regulation, later on they pulled it out and said, it's market process should play, and if there is a problem, I'll intervene. So that was one thing that seen. I believe this market will also see the same thing, and I hope, unlike some industries, the over-regulation don't kill the market. So on that note, I would like to thank all the panelists, and if time permits, in case any of the people around on the floor would like to have any queries, we can go for one or two if time permits on that one. They had the patience to look at us. So. I think it's a big demon and animal, I will say, from an environmental laws perspective. There is a regulation or a notification of 2006 by which any building which crosses a threshold of 20,000 square feet, square meters, need to get an approval. But there has been multiple judgments of High Court, notifications, office memorandums, which has been swinging the pendulum left, right, and center. And in the last 12 years, things have been going this side to other side. And I think it's still in an area of quorum where we don't even know what's the right law is. So interpretation of law is a very big thing, which is will be here over there.
My question was really, how do you build the risk appetite for future environmental aspects that may come on
people? I'd like to answer that. When I discussed about the single window clearance, environmental law was one of that subset. But due to the paucity of time, I could not bring that. Let's be very frank today. Earlier, it was 20,000. The threshold limit. Developers knew under 20,000, no need to go to the state authorities or to the union authorities. Then it's 50,000. Sooner or later, there were certain post-facto approvals which were being enacted through office memorandum. They were struck down by NGT. Then, during 2013-14, came up this concept of self-certification by the municipal authorities of environmental clearance. The threshold was increased to the extent of 1,50,000 square meters. So developers have been planning their time of construction and the time period required for obtaining environmental clearance in this fashion. Today, if you ask me, as a lawyer representing a developer, we have no foresight of it. The matter is still pending before the Supreme Court, before NGT, on what should be the course of action today with respect to the threshold limit, with respect to what threshold should be vested with the municipal authorities and what threshold should be vested with MOEF. So future course of action, we're really unclear. We're just waiting for further orders to come up from the authorities and from the court.
Uncertainty is the rule of the game in real estate.
Yeah.
I think on that note, I will end the session. Thank you all for your patience hearing. Thank you.